Get ready for scary. This is Shocktober number 5. Boo.
Pull the string! Pull the string!
And this is Danny Dixon, and this is Danny Dixon. How did he get that way? With Mattel's new Fright Factory and his Thing Maker. Just plug it in, pour in genuine plastic goop, and out come fangs, claws, shrunken heads, and all sorts of scary things. Mattel's new Fright Factory. No wonder everybody calls Danny Dixon a little monster.
The room was warm. The curtains were closed. The two table lamps were lit. On the cupboard behind her, there were two glasses and some drinks. Mary Maloney was waiting for her husband to come home from work. Now and again, she glanced at the clock, but without anxiety. She merely wanted to satisfy herself that each minute that went by made it nearer the time when he would come home. As she bent over her sewing, she was curiously peaceful. This was her 6th month expecting a child. Her mouth and her eyes, with their new calm look, seemed larger and darker than before. When the clock said 5:10, she began to listen, and a few moments later, punctually as always, she heard the car tires on the stones outside, the car doors closing, footsteps passing the window, the key turning in the lock. She stood up and went forward to kiss him as he entered. "Hello, darling," she said.
"Hello," he answered.
She took his coat and hung it up. Then she made the drinks, a strong one for him and a weak one for herself. And soon she was back again in her chair with the sewing, and he was in the other chair holding the tall glass, rolling it gently so that the ice knocked musically against the side of the glass. For her, this was always a wonderful time of day. She knew he didn't want to speak much until the first drink was finished, and she was satisfied to sit quietly, enjoying his company after the long hours alone in the house. She loved the warmth that came out of him when they were alone together. She loved the shape of his mouth, and she especially liked the way he didn't complain about being tired.
"Tired, darling?"
"Yes," he sighed. "I'm thoroughly exhausted."
And as he spoke, he did an unusual thing. He lifted his glass and drank it down in one swallow, although there was still half of it left. He got up and went slowly to get himself another drink.
"I'll get it,"
she cried, jumping up.
"Sit down," he said.
When he came back, she noticed that the new drink was a very strong one. She watched him as he began to drink.
"I think it's a shame," she said, "that when someone's been a policeman as long as you have, he still has to walk around all day long."
He didn't answer.
"Darling," she said, "if you're too tired to eat out tonight as we had planned, I can fix you something. There's plenty of meat and stuff in the freezer."
Her eyes waited to an answer, a smile, a nod, but he made no sign.
"Anyway," she went on, "I'll get you some bread and cheese."
"I don't want it,"
he said.
She moved uneasily in her chair.
"But you have to have supper. I can easily fix you something. I'd like to do it. We can have lamb, anything you want. Everything's in the freezer."
"Forget it,"
he said. "But darling, you have to eat. I'll do it anyway, and then you can have it or not, as you like."
She stood up and placed her sewing on the table by the lamp.
"Sit down," he said. "Just for a minute, sit down."
It wasn't until then that she began to get frightened.
"Go on," he said. "Sit down."
She lowered herself into the chair, watching him all the time with large, puzzled eyes. He had finished his second drink and was staring into the glass.
"Listen," he said. "I've got something to tell you."
"What is it, darling? What's the matter?"
He became absolutely motionless, and he kept his head down.
"This is going to be a big shock to you, I'm afraid,"
he said.
"But I've thought about it a good deal, and I've decided that the only thing to do is to tell you immediately."
And he told her. It didn't take long, 4 or 5 minutes at most, and she sat still through it all, watching him with puzzled horror.
"So there it is,"
he added.
"And I know it's a tough time to be telling you this, but there simply wasn't any other way. Of course, I'll give you money and see that you're taken care of, but there really shouldn't be any problem. I hope not, in any case. It wouldn't be very good for my job."
Her first instinct was not to believe any of it. She thought that perhaps she'd imagined the whole thing. Perhaps, if she acted as though she had not heard him, she would find out that none of it had ever happened.
"I'll fix some supper,"
she whispered. When she walked across the room, she couldn't feel her feet touching the floor. She couldn't feel anything except a slight sickness. She did everything without thinking. She went downstairs to the freezer and took hold of the first object she found. She lifted it out and looked at it. It was wrapped in paper, so she took off the paper and looked at it again. A leg of lamb. All right then, they would have lamb for supper. She carried it upstairs, held the thin end with both of her hands. She went into the living room, saw him standing by the window with his back to her, and stopped.
"I've already told you,"
he said.
"Don't make supper for me. I'm going out."
At that point, Mary Maloney simply walked up behind him and, without any pause, she swung the big frozen leg of lamb high in the air and brought it down as hard as she could on the back of his head. She might as well have hit him with a steel bar. She stepped back, waiting, and the strange thing was that he remained standing there for at least 4 or 5 seconds. Then he crashed onto the carpet. The violence of the crash, the noise, the small table overturning, helped to bring her out of the shock. She came out slowly, feeling cold and surprised, and she stood for a few minutes.
looking at the body, still holding the piece of meat tightly with both hands.
All right, she told herself. So I've killed him. It was extraordinary now how clear her mind became all of a sudden. She began thinking very fast. As the wife of a detective, she knew what the punishment would be. It made no difference to her. In fact, it would be a relief. On the other hand, what about the baby? What were the laws about murderers with unborn children? Did they kill them both, mother and child? Did they wait until the baby was born? What did they do? Mary Maloney didn't know, and she wasn't prepared to take a chance. She carried the meat into the kitchen, put it into a pan, turned on the oven, and put the pan inside. Then she washed her hands, ran upstairs, sat down in front of the mirror, fixed her makeup, and tried to smile. The smile was rather peculiar. She tried again. "Hello, Sam," she said, brightly, aloud. The voice sounded peculiar, too. "I want some potatoes, Sam, yes, and perhaps a can of beans." That was better. Both the smile and the voice sounded better now. She practiced them several times more. Then she ran downstairs, took her coat, and went out the back door, through the garden, and into the street. It wasn't 6 o'clock yet, and the lights were still on in the neighborhood grocery. "Hello, Sam," she said brightly, smiling at the man in the shop. "Good evening, Mrs. Maloney. How are you?" "I want some potatoes, please, Sam. Yes, and perhaps a can of beans, too. Patrick's decided he's tired and doesn't want to eat out tonight," she told him. "We usually go out on Thursdays, you know, and now I don't have any vegetables in the house."
"Then how about some meat, Ms. Maloney?" asked the grocer.
"No, I've got meat, thanks. I've got a nice leg of lamb in the freezer."
"You want these potatoes, Ms. Maloney?"
"Oh, yes, they'll be fine. 2 pounds, please."
"Anything else?" The grocer turned his head to one side, looking at her. "How about dessert? What are you going to give him for dessert? How about a nice piece of cake? I know he likes cake."
"Perfect," she said. "He loves it."
And when she had bought and paid for everything, she gave her bride a smile and said,
"Thank you, Sam. Good night."
And now, she told herself as she hurried back home, she was returning to her husband, and he was waiting for his supper. She had to cook it well and make it taste as good as possible, because the poor man was tired. And if she found anything unusual or terrible when she got home, then it would be a shock, and she would have to react with grief and horror. Of course, she was not expecting to find anything unusual at home. She was just going home with the vegetables on Thursday evening to cook dinner for husband. "That's the way," she told herself. "Do everything normally. Keep things absolutely natural, and there'll be no need for acting at all." As she entered the kitchen by the back door, she was quietly singing to herself. "Patrick," she called. "How are you, darling?" She put the package on the table and went into the living room. And when she saw him lying there on the floor, it really was a shock. All the old love for him came back to her. She ran over to him, knelt down beside him, and began to cry hard. It was easy. No acting was necessary. A few minutes later, she got up and went to the phone. She knew the number of the police station, and when the man at the other end answered, she cried to him,
"Quick, come quickly, Patrick's dead."
"Who's speaking?"
"Mrs. Maloney, Mrs. Patrick Maloney."
"Do you mean that Patrick's dead?"
"I think so," she cried. "He's lying on the floor and I think he's dead."
"We'll be there immediately," the man said. The car came very quickly, and when she opened the front door, 2 policemen walked in. She knew them both. She knew nearly all the men at the police station. She fell into Jack Noonan's arms, crying uncontrollably. He put her gently into a chair.
"Is he dead?" she cried.
"I'm afraid he is." "What happened?" In a few words, she told her story about going to the grocer and coming back when she found him on the floor. While she was crying and talking, Noonan found some dried blood on the dead man's head. He hurried to the phone. Some other men began to arrive. A doctor, 2 detectives, a police photographer, and a man who knew about fingerprints. The detectives kept asking her a lot of questions. They always treated her kindly. She told them how and she'd put the meat into the oven. It's there now. And now she'd gone to the grocer's for vegetables, and now she came back to find him lying on the floor. The 2 detectives were exceptionally nice to her. They searched the house. Sometimes Jack Noonan spoke to her gently. He told her that her husband had been killed by a blow to the back of the head. They were looking for the weapon.
The murderer might have taken it with him, but he might have thrown it away or hidden it. It's the old story, he said. Get the weapon, and you've got the murderer. Later, one of the detectives sat down beside her. Did she know, he asked, of anything in the house that could have been used as a weapon? Would she look around to see if anything was missing? The search went on. It began to get late. It was nearly 9 o'clock. The men searching the rooms were getting tired.
Jack, she said, would you like a drink? You must be extremely tired.
Well, he answered, it's not allowed by police rules, but since you're a friend. They stood around with drinks in their hands. The detectives were uncomfortable with her, and they tried to say cheering things to her. Jack Noonan walked into the kitchen, came out quickly, and said, look, Mrs. Maloney, did you know that your oven is still on and the meat is still inside?
Oh, she said. So it is. I'd better turn it off.
She returned with tearful eyes.
Would you do me a favor? Here you all are, all good friends of Patrick, and you're trying to help catch the man who killed him. You must be very hungry by now because it's long past your supper time, and I know that Patrick would never forgive me if I let you stay in the house without offering you anything to eat. Why don't you eat up the lamb in the oven?
I wouldn't dream of it, Noonan said.
Please,
she begged.
Personally, I couldn't eat a thing, but it'd be a favor to me if you ate it up. Then you can go on with your work.
The detectives hesitated, but they were hungry, and in the end they went into the kitchen and helped themselves to supper. The woman stayed where she was and listened to them through the open door. She could hear them speaking among themselves, and their voices were thick because their mouths were full of meat.
Have some more, Charlie.
Nah, we'd better not finish it.
She wants us to finish it. She said we ought to eat it up.
That's a big bar the murderer must have used to hit poor Patrick. The doctor says the back of his head was broken to pieces.
That's why the weapon should be easy to find.
Exactly what I say.
Whoever did it, he can't carry a weapon that big around with him.
Personally, I think the weapon is somewhere near the house. It's probably right under our noses. What do you think, Jack? And in the other room, Mary Maloney began to laugh.
I hold your hand in mine, dear. I press it to my lips. I take a healthy bite from your dainty fingertips. My joy would be complete, dear, if you were only here. But still I keep your hand as a precious souvenir. The night you died, I cut it off. I really don't know why. For now each time I kiss it, I get blood stains on my tie. I'm sorry now I killed you, for our love was something fine. Until they come to get me, I shall hold your hand in mine.
Victims? Don't be melodramatic.
Down there, would you really feel any pity if one of those dots stopped moving forever? If I offered you £20,000 for every dot that stopped, would you really, old man, tell me to keep my money? Or would you calculate how many dots you could afford to spend? Free of income tax, old man. Free of income tax.
Bluebeard, a man with an eye for beauty, an ear for music, an appreciation for talent. Burton is Bluebeard. He had a way with the world's most beautiful women. He did away with them.
Why did you kill them?
Why else? They deserve to die.
One, he shot. One, he drowned. One he falconated.
Help!
One he froze. One he chopped. One he coffined. Two he chandeliered. Richard Burton as Bluebeard.
Do you like me?
Of course.
Do you love me?
With Raquel Welch.
He was so kind, so gentle.
Verna Lisi.
Oh, lover, when I near you.
Natalie Delon. Mary Lou Tolo. Karen Schubert. Sybil Danning. Agostina Belli. And Joey Heatherton.
The great hero, trembling at the thought that his myth might collapse.
Burton. Bluebeard.
And now, our feature presentation.
And a very good evening
Hello,
to you.
Warwick. Well, well. What'll you have?
What'll you have?
Okay, on you then. I don't mind.
Fancy somewhere a bit quieter. Like over there in the corner. Got a story to tell you.
Oh?
Hmm. Remember the story about Mendingham you told me? I've got as good a one to tell you. Been hoping I'd see you. Had it straight from the filly's mouth, so to speak. The usual? Frank, double scotches. Two, please.
There's something ghoulish in your manner this evening, Warwick. You going to try and scare me?
Listen and see. Ever been to Borneo?
Biotex, the new soap and pre-wash powder, presents Beyond Midnight by Michael McKay.
Biotech. If you have wondered how to get your washing really stain-free, understand this. Biotech removes the stains and dirt washing won't.
Just soak in Biotech.
Stains, grass stains, tiresome collar and cuff stains, ingrained dirt, soil and grime. Out they all come, and you don't stir a finger.
Just soak in Biotech.
Biotech with natural enzymes is the pre-wash powder with the most enzymes to give you extra pre-wash power. Absolutely no rubbing, no color loss, no fabric wear. Use it for cottons, silks, woolens, synthetics. Use it to make new again. Soaking in Biotech removes the stains and dirt that washing won't.
Just soak in Biotech.
Okay, fire away. I'm all ears.
I won't make the obvious remark. One thing, my story, it isn't for sale. Well, what I mean is this, it's given today free, gratis, and for nothing, friend to friend. But you don't make 200 guineas out of it by saying...
I'm not that hard up for a yarn yet, Warwick. Carry on. Interest me. Your story?
It's a wild tale. Two planters, interior of Borneo, and as usual, there's a woman, a veritable golden-haired filly, only her mane is streaked with grey, and there's a great livid scar or weal right round her neck. She's the wife of George String. At the other end of the triangle is Clifford Macy. The men were partners on a small experimental estate far up in the interior. They'd been at it for 6 years and were about to reap the fruits of their labors very handsomely. And then Thring went on home leave and came back with a bride. Her name was Rona, and that was the beginning of the trouble. Macy flirted, philandered, and then fell violently in love with her. Come here, Bert. Don't scare.
What bird?
A bird. Why give it a name? A bird's a bird. Tree's a tree.
No, Peter. Just... How strange. You've been here 6 years and you can't call a bird by its proper name. Is it a long-tailed cloppet or scarlet speckled ditch hopper? Have you a cigarette?
Stop looking at the door. He's 45 miles away. It's all right.
All right for you.
We won't be back till tonight. You've got all the time in the world.
Peter.
I ought to plug that bird, oughtn't I? He messed up our little scene. All right, relax. You're sweating. Sorry, madam. Perspiring. But you can see I wasn't brung up like you. Decent with tablecloths and pretty china, the vicar to tea on Sundays. Oh, Rona.
You don't do things by halves, do you? When you drink, you want to fight. When you love...
I go all out. Marry me, Rona.
I've already got one husband. I'm not a woman.
You know what I mean. Let's clear out.
Plantation.
The plantation can go and...
You'll be sorry tomorrow morning.
Never.
All that money. I like you, Peter.
Thanks.
And I know what to be friends with you.
Look, the other night on the river, that was more than friendship, Rona. Yeah. All the words you said then, the worlds we inhabited. Friends? Friends, yes, we were friends, but more. Or were you pretending, playing a game?
No. Yes, sir. No. Peter, I don't know. I can't decide.
Well, that's too bad. You've got to. If I want to shout, I'll bally well shout. Are too busy sorting out their own love problems. Rona.
I want to finish my cigarette. Would you like a drink?
No, I don't want to finish your cigarette. I don't want a drink either. I want... She fell between two stools, you see. So many women of a certain type do. She began by being just friendly and kind, cheering the lonely man up, and drifted into the eternal game of all womankind, flirting. And then, well, too late she realized she couldn't put the fire out, either hers or Macy's. Thring was, in many ways, easygoing, but at the same time possessed of a curiously intense strain of jealous possessiveness. He was generous, too. If asked, he would gladly give away his last shirt or crust. But let him think or feel that his rights were being taken or curtailed, and he was a tough customer with rather primitive ideas. Macy made no attempt to hide his feelings. The woman was sitting on a volcano. For her husband, of course, became suspicious. He watched, though, with the cunning of an iguana.
Rona?
You frightened me.
All right.
Oh, rain. Slowed down the work on the plantation, hasn't it? Would it lose us much money?
No, not much. You're not looking well.
Looking well?
I said, not looking well. You know, darling, this rain is spell. It's getting us all down. Why don't you go home for a while?
Home?
Yes, my love, home. Hampshire in June. Can't you imagine it? It's only been 18 months. Long, cool evenings on the downs, the sea at Bournemouth, concerts at Portsmouth. Oh, Jack wrote to say the Royal Philharmonic is coming. Oh, you love music, Rona. There's no chance here. Only the gramophone.
Why should you think I want to go to England? No, it's just this eternal rain. I'll be all right when it's over. Well, the rain's a...
Darling, your health comes first.
Oh, my health is perfect.
You look pale, thin. You're...
I've never known you to be so solicitous, George. Why you...
Now, don't stay here out of duty to me, my dear.
Please. George, let's not talk about it anymore.
Ah, I see.
You see?
Borneo, the jungle. It's captivated you, won you completely. You couldn't bear to be away from it. England, dreams of her rolling hills and green dells gone forever.
No, I wouldn't put it like that. I'd like to go home one day, but...
Or is it something else?
What?
Something else that you don't wish to leave at the moment.
George, I assure you, it's merely the weather.
Or someone else. Yes, that's it. My goodness, of course. How could I have been so blind? It's someone else. My poor little Rona. How you must be
George,
suffering.
I'm in no mood for play acting. I'm going to bed.
Rona, please don't turn away. I'm talking to you. Rona? Rona, I said please do not walk away. Your husband is talking to you.
Tonight. I don't think I've ever...
I won't keep you long,
like
Angel, but there is something I think we ought to sort out.
Well?
My darling, I am going to ask you a question. I have a little suspicion, you see. If I am wrong, I shall fall upon your feet and kiss them and be your slave forever and beg your forgiveness.
George, please, what is all that?
Are you having an affair with my partner, one Peter Macy? I'm sorry, darling, did I speak too softly? Perhaps you didn't hear me.
I said, George, you must be mad.
I have watched month after month. I have watched our worthy friend Macy become more openly amorous. I have seen secret glances. I have seen the way the looks that have passed
George,
between you. The looks have become less and less.
How?
Less guarded. Neither of you even care anymore. You treat me like an imbecile.
You're mad.
Admit it, Rona. Admit
it. No.
Admit it.
Leave me alone. I want to go to bed.
Admit that you've been deceiving me with
Macy. George, this has gone too far. All right, I'll go.
Kill me.
Yes, yes, yes. We're lovers. Yes. Been lovers for 4 months.
So, like a blithering and sublime little idiot, she admitted it was all true. And after the initial outburst, Thring took it like a lamb. In reality, he must have been burning mad, a mass of white-hot revenge. Unbeknown to either Rona or Peter Macy, he plotted his revenge. And it must surely go down in the annals of affairs such as this as one of the most diabolical ever contemplated.
I feel like a new man. It's a lovely day today.
I thought you had flu.
I took a grandpa headache powder, and I'm worlds better.
When colds and flu are about, grandpa headache powders are what you need. Grandpa headache powders work fast because they dissolve almost immediately. Grandpa makes all those dreadful flu symptoms disappear quickly. So, whenever you're in pain, get fast relief. Get grandpa headache powder.
Ah, grandpa.
Just soak in Biotex.
Stains, grass stains, collar and cuff stains, ingrained dirt, soil and grime. Out they come and you don't stir a finger.
Just soak, Just soak in Biotex.
Biotex with natural enzymes is the pre-wash powder with the most enzymes to give you extra pre-wash power. Absolutely no rubbing, no color loss, no fabric wear. Soaking in Biotex removes the stains and dirt that washing won't.
Just soak in Biotex.
There came a lull before the storm. Fate played a hand. Macy went sick with malaria, really ill. And George String had to admit the necessity for Rona to nurse him practically night and day. Macy owed his recovery to her care. But even so, convalescence was a long job. In the end, Rona too crocked up through overwork, and String had them both on his hands. This was an opportunity better than he could have planned it. It separated the lovers and gave him complete control. The rains were over. The jungle had ceased wintering and spring was in the air. The young grass and vegetation were shooting into life, new life. Concurrently, all the creepy, crawly insect life of the jungle and plantation was young and vigorous and hungry too. These facts gave the husband the germ of an idea which he was not slow to perfect. An idea as devilish as man could devise. In Borneo, there is a kind of a mammoth earwig,
a thing as fine and gossamer as a spider's web, as long as a good-sized caterpillar.
And it lives on waxy secretions. These are integral parts of some flowers and trees and lie buried deep in their recesses.
It's one of the terrors of these tropics, because it moves and rests so lightly on a human being that one is practically unconscious of it. And, like its English relation, it has
a decided liking for the human ear. It was a terrible plan, to put the giant earwig in Macy's hair, just above the ear.
Once in his ear, it's a 1,000-to-1 chance against it ever coming out the same way. It would be impossible to turn. To back out would be an impossibility. And so, feeding as it goes, it would crawl right across inside the head.
Surely the rains aren't coming back again, George, are they? I don't think I could bear it.
No. That's just the old storm having a last blow. It's all over. It's spring now.
Oh.
Don't worry, sweetheart. It's all over. Well, I must go and minister to our other patient. Don't you want to know how he is?
How is he today? He should be pretty well recovered by now.
Oh, he is. He is. Said only yesterday he can't wait to get back to work. I must admit I shall be glad. There's a lot of work he's doing right now. This is the year when all our pains are awarded.
I think I'll get up tomorrow, George. I can take some of the burden from you. Must have been awful for you having two invalids around the place.
Well, don't mention it. Those closest to me are sick. What am I to do?
Several days passed. Rona String began to nurse Macy in the last days of his recovery. It was late afternoon. Spring was really in, as they say. Borneo.
It'll be dark soon. Bats are about already. They're fruit bats, aren't they? I must light the lamps for you.
You care well for me, Rona. I wish I had you with me all the time.
Oh, please, Peter, don't say anything else about all that. We must try and forget now, because...
But...
What's the matter? Peter, what is it?
My head! My ear! Merciful heavens, my ear!
That was the beginning. Rona did all she could, but there was nothing to see. nothing to treat. Then for a while, Macy would be quiet, because the earwig was quiet. Then the vile thing would move or feed again, and... Ring came each day to Macy's bungalow. He was very helpful.
Here, drink this, old man. I think this is the best way to take the drug. It's foul without water.
Unbeknown to the wife, or the lover, of course, friend Thring had cast the dose of pain-relieving drug down the sink, and Macy was swallowing plain water.
This way it dissolves, and you can't even see it.
George, we've got to get a doctor.
I know, but... Well, you know how many miles that is away.
No, it's okay. It's just migraine. When I was a child, I used to have headaches. Wait. The doctor's too far. Miles and miles away. It's impossible. There's too much work here.
George, we'll have to get the labor in. He'll have to be carried down to the coast to the doctor.
Rhoda, come here a minute. Darling, we can't lose him. The malaria and this thing, he's not strong enough. Not yet. The moment he's gained a bit more strength, we will. But I promise you, it'd kill him if we took him now.
And so the work on the plantation went on. Rhoda nursed her former lover. Her husband went about the task of running the plantation. The laborers labored, the sun shone. And in the small darkened bungalow that was Macy's, its occupant lost weight and suffered the agonies of the damned. Gone now were all thoughts of love, illicit or otherwise. He could summon up no interest in the lovely, golden-haired woman who was constantly by his side. The drugs were having an effect, because, of course, when she administered them, she did the job properly. Strangely enough, Macy didn't connect the relief he felt when Rhoda gave him his drugs to a complete failure of those drugs when the husband played nursemaid. During the days that passed, an awful lot of creepy crawlies down the plantation drainage system must have died. Their supply of painkilling medicine must have been near to running out, too, when the end came. Again, it was late afternoon. Dusk was just falling. Bats were flying about, and they were heavy with fruit returning home.
Wish I could die. Too much. I can't take it any longer.
Both Thring and Rhoda were present. Macy must have suffered an excruciating pain, followed by a period of quiescence. Then, feeling a slight tickling sensation on his cheek, he put up his hand to rub or scratch. His fingers came into contact with the earwig and its fine gossamer hairs. He naturally was curious and looked to see what he was holding. Slowly, he realized.
What an escape? What an escape?
I don't understand. What do you mean?
Only Thring kept quiet. And that, of course, was a mistake. This silence worried Macy, weak though he was. He looked from Rhoda to George Thring, and at the critical moment, George Thring could not meet his eyes. The truth was out. Macy threw the insect, now dead from the pressure of his fingers, from him, tried to rise, and then fell back. Slowly, George Thring walked to where the earwig had fallen, picked it up, and studiously examined it. And from his pocket, he produced a magnifying glass he used daily for the inspection and detection of leaf disease on certain plants. As Rhoda watched, she saw the fear and disappointment leave her husband's face to be replaced by a look of cunning and evil satisfaction. Then, for the first time, he spoke.
Macy
looked up. Thring held up the earwig.
This is dead now. As dead as my friendship for you. As dead as my love for that That creature who was my wife is dead. Dead. But it's a female. Do you get me? This earwig's a female. And a female lays eggs. And before I put it in your hair, it was...
Haven't touched your drink, Cook, old man.
Huh? Oh. But I mean...
Oh, there was nothing anyone could say or do. Friend Macy made to get up and then fainted. Rona ran screaming from the bungalow. Her husband followed, snatching as he went a long Borneo native's knife from the wall. He caught her and slashed her, marked her neck. She's got the scar to this day. I think I'll have another whiskey.
Macy, what?
Well, he died, of course. No doctor could operate. The thing had laid eggs in his brain. Thring was tried for his murder. The wife, Rona, told everything to the authorities, but nothing was believed, of course. I mean, the story could never have happened, could it?
She's a pretty wretched creature today.
Her husband is hopelessly insane, so they say. Anyway, he's in the lunatic asylum for life. Sir? There it is. A waiter. Two double whiskies and sodas, please.
Just soak in biotech.
If you have wondered how to get your washing really stain-free, understand this. Biotech removes the stains and dirt washing won't.
Just soak in biotech.
Stains, grass stains, tiresome collar and cuff stains, ingrained dirt, soil and grime. Out they all come, and you don't stir a finger.
Just soak in biotech.
Biotech with natural enzymes is the pre-wash powder with the most enzymes to give you extra pre-wash power. Absolutely no rubbing, no color loss, no fabric wear. Use it for cottons, silks, woolens, synthetics. Use it to make new again. Soaking in biotech removes the stains and dirt that washing won't.
Just soak in biotech.
In Beyond Midnight, next week, we're broadcasting The Room. This is a rather frightening tale in the great tradition of ghost stories. The room in question is in the north wing of a house owned by a certain Mrs. Watts. The house has been in her family for many years, and the room in the north wing has a very terrible reputation. No one who has spent a night there has been found in the same condition as they went in when the door is opened the next morning. A duke, a well-known ghost hunter and dabbler in the supernatural, slept in the yellow room, and the results were terrifying. Before the great window was blocked in, one poor inmate jumped to the ground below to his death. Mrs. Watts herself has never dared spend more than a few minutes there. But she's an old woman now, and by her own admittance,
She can't bear the thought of dying without knowing just what it is that haunts a person who spends a night in the room. Consequently, she offers £1,000, and Ronald Todd takes up the offer. The haunting of Ronald Todd is eerie and inexplicable, and at the very end of the story, there is a surprise which might anger and puzzle, but will certainly intrigue.
Beyond Midnight is presented every Friday night at 9:30 by Biotex, the new soap and pre-wash powder.